Hi, everyone. I am Christina Jang from Trust for Public Land's 10-Minute Walk Program, and I'd like to welcome you to today's Park Bench Chat on park development as equitable development. During today's panel discussion, we will hear about how cities are using innovative policies and practices that leverage parks as a tool for equitable development. So let me go ahead and get us started here. Before we dive in, I want to say hello to those who do not know the Trust for Public Land. Trust for Public Land is a national not-for-profit working to create parks and protect land for people, ensuring healthy, livable communities for generations to come. Trust for Public Land, in close collaboration with communities, partners, and all levels of government, is working to connect everyone to the outdoors. We do this work in a number of ways, including by helping local leaders commit, assess, and prioritize access to parks via making the 10-minute walk commitment, as well as key tools and case-making research via the Land and People Lab. We also help create the resources and an environment for park systems to thrive, including by focusing on policy, funding, and cross-sector partners. And then lastly, of course, we work to protect land and build park spaces. We do so hand in hand with community partners and deep civic and community engagement so that parks and lands are responsive to local needs, priorities, and culture. And we pursue all of this work because we know that parks and outside access have tremendous health, climate and environmental, economic, and community benefits. We also know that communities that engage with parks are stronger. They're more cohesive and more civically engaged. There are important ripple effects when people have access and opportunities to inform, use, and love these important places. Parks and green spaces can help address some of the most urgent challenges of today and tomorrow. They link neighbors to each other, provide space for leisure and exercise, and create shade and protection from weather events. They offer powerful opportunities to build healthy and connected neighborhoods and places that people want to live, work, and play. Furthermore, as cities are looking for ways to attract and retain a stable workforce, we need to highlight the role that parks play on urban livability, sustainability, and growth. While there's increasing research and awareness of these multiple benefits that parks bring, we are still faced with the glaring park equity divide. Part of this challenge in addressing this gap is that parks continue to effectively remain a tier three issue. They are undervalued and they are underprioritized. And this perpetuates inequitable planning and investment practices in cities. The park equity divide actually expands when we think about parks that are not sufficiently maintained, when they don't serve local needs, lack safe routes, or seen here are an unwelcoming or otherwise uninviting space. In the US today, 100 million people, including 28 million children, do not have access to a park within a 10-minute walk of home. And parks that do exist are not necessarily created equal or equitably. But we're at an important moment in time where we can come together to shift this work and dialogue as a part of a broader conversation and efforts to help make our communities more equitable, healthy, and resilient. Prioritizing high-quality amenities like parks in low-income neighborhoods, working-class areas, and underserved communities of colors, like the ones that we see in wealthy neighborhoods, is a key strategy to advance equity in cities. So how do we create equitable public policies that are rooted in the lived experiences and challenges that residents face? Luckily, we have examples and people leading the charge to integrate parks and green spaces as a key driver of local prosperity, equity, and the quality of life that we see in cities. Joining us today, we are very excited to have the city of Lancaster, Pennsylvania, to share how parks and green spaces plant seeds and create pathways to reducing disparities, and as an outcome, working towards creating strong, livable communities. We're thrilled to have you here today, Mayor Sirachi, and want to extend our deep thanks and excitement for this panel. Moderating our discussion, we have John Sirico, journalist, researcher, and friend. John focuses on cities and how they're changing, and his reporting on these topics can be found in the New York Times, Bloomberg, and The Guardian. He is a senior fellow for climate and opportunity at Center for an Urban Future, a leading think tank in New York City. He also teaches urban reporting at New York University's Arthur L. Carter Journalism Institute. John, thank you so much for joining us today, and I hand it off to you to open the discussion.
Thanks, Christina. And thanks everyone for being here. I think I speak on behalf of so many people here, where I've long been a fan of TPL's work and research. I've used it so many times in my day-to-day, so it's an honor to be able to host this chat and be able to moderate this chat. We had a last-minute programming update where the Deputy Mayor of Infrastructure from Los Angeles, Randall Winston, unfortunately can't make it today. So it will be a one-on-one chat with me and Mayor Deneen Sirachi from Lancaster, a city I love and been to many times, so I'm excited to chat. So without further ado, I'd love to introduce the mayor. Just some background. Mayor Deneen Sirachi serves as the 43rd mayor of Lancaster. She brings her experience as a nonprofit leader, an environmental advocate, city councilor, to the role of mayor. She has set forth the vision of building a stronger, more equitable Lancaster, block by block, underscored by four strategic priorities, which I'd love to talk about. Strong neighborhoods, safe places, sustainable economy, and sound government. Welcome, Mayor.
It's so great to be with you, John. And I'm imagining on this beautiful summer day here in Pennsylvania, us sitting on a park bench. So I love that we're just chatting away, and we've got 100 people that are joining us in our park. And I'm just imagining being there instead of in my office.
I imagine every Zoom to be on a park bench. Mayor, let's kind of just hear, just generally speaking, to tell folks in the audience who might not know about Lancaster, PA, tell us a bit about the city.
Okay, so Lancaster, Pennsylvania is often thought of in terms of horse and buggies and Amish. If you live on the East Coast, especially if you've been in a surrounding state, you may have come here with your family to visit Dutch Wonderland, ride in a horse and buggy at Jake's, or visit one of our smorgasbords. But Lancaster City itself is a city of 60,000 people. We are a majority city of Latinx, Hispanic communities from and have a very large refugee population here in the city of Lancaster. And so we're, at first blush, we're not what people think that we are. We were written up in the New York Times for our food scene. We have an incredible ethnic food experience here in Lancaster, which is often a pleasant surprise to people who are coming to visit. All of that is really part and parcel of the history of the city being a welcoming city, and we are the first certified welcoming city in Pennsylvania. And I believe that's really important for us because it's both honoring the contributions of so many people of our past. I was just meeting with a Native American woman who is doing work here in the city, as well as honoring the many communities that have used Lancaster as a place to resettle and to build their lives. So it's both an honor of that and a moment of looking towards the future and understanding that there's still a lot of work to do. Our vision is to build a stronger and more equitable Lancaster block by block, and parks are certainly part of that.
I think you characterized my family trips to Lancaster quite well, but it's a lovely place. I know I went to a lot of the vintage train kind of.
Stratford Railroad. Yeah, there's another.
Yeah, incepted my love of transit at a young age. Let's talk a bit about the equitable development strategy that you mentioned. It has these four pillars. Can you talk a bit about the four pillars and really about the strategy writ large?
Yeah, so our strategy, I mean, this really started, and for anybody who's an elected official on this call, you know that when you're knocking on doors as part of a campaign, it really does crystallize the things that you want to accomplish as an elected official. And so strong neighborhoods are certainly part of that. Parks are part of that. Safe places, again, we want our streets to be safe. We want our neighborhoods to be safe. How are we thinking about the connection of safety as an ambulance goes by. The third is really around economic impacts and making sure that everybody has a chance to realize their fullest potential. And then last but not least, a sound government, because we know that the trust in government is at a low, and local officials are the closest form of government to their residents, and that we have this unique opportunity to help people connect to their government. We've been doing a lot of work around voter engagement and civic engagement writ large. We understand the role of democracy and how all of this works together. So I'm really excited to talk about those priorities and to also talk about some of the work we've been doing as part of our comprehensive plan, because we haven't had one since an update since 1993. So, and parks are a big part of what we are thinking about related to our comp plan and the future of the city.
Yeah, I'd love to hear about that. I know you mentioned it earlier that you see parks as part of this equitable development strategy. Of course, why do you see parks as part of it? And I would love to hear a bit more.
Well, I think folks on the call would maybe say similar things, which is that parks are for everyone. And the mission statement of the Trust for Public Land, I mean, when we got connected with them, there was just so much synergy around their mission statement and what we are trying to do. We know we are a very dense city of 60,000 people and in about 4 square miles, although there's some additional suburban annexes that were sort of added on to us in the 60s. But what I would say is that parks and that open space is the place for communities to come together and have those kinds of natural connections that build strong neighborhoods. And we know that that's not something that just passively happens. And that is part of the work that we're doing here in the city.
So you mentioned how there hasn't been a comprehensive plan since the early 90s, basically since right around when I was born. So an entire lifetime. And Lancaster's changed quite dramatically since then. It's growing quite a lot. I would love to just hear about how you've seen parks play a role in that time period, in that growth of Lancaster.
Yeah, so I would say that it's been really my honor to expand our parks as mayor. We've been, it's slow going because always it's like how you figure out the funding, and we'll get to that a little bit later. But for me, the way that I see parks as part of that and what we've been doing related to the comp plan is really being intentional about the areas in the city that don't have as many park resources and how we are creating spaces for families and communities to engage in outdoor space. And so we've done just a lot of things around how to connect public art into our park spaces, how to think about sustainability in our park spaces. So a lot of stormwater management practices and things like that, how we've engaged neighborhoods in helping develop what the program is for a park and what they see as their needs and priorities. We are adding a brand new park, which is a little pocket park. We're also about to add a very significant, if the comp plan is passed, a 50-acre park, which would be the largest park in the city on my watch. And I'm super proud of that opportunity to think about that park as a way to connect to historically underserved neighborhoods that have not had as much access to a green space that's wild, you know, not just playing fields, but places where you can sit along the river, where you can have walking paths and trails along the river, but then you can also, you know, sit and observe snow geese flying in and, you know, just that kind of beauty, that natural beauty that we want, as well as parks that have playgrounds and all the rest of it.
So I'd love to, a little later, dive into those specific projects and the kind of processes of them coming into being. But first, I wanted to kind of go back. You mentioned that Lancaster is a welcoming city, but it's also a designated welcoming city. Yeah. I haven't heard this designation, so I'd love to hear what that means, how it relates to your city's priorities, and also you know, how parks can kind of fit into this, even though you've kind of described them as being these welcoming community spaces.
Yeah, so Welcoming America is an organization that I believe is based in Ohio. And it's one of those designated, like, you know, lots of cities get designated for lots of things, but this is one that you actually have to like complete a pretty rigorous application and send a check in for. But we thought it was very important for us to document and demonstrate all the ways that we were really working to become a welcoming city. So for the example, on my second or third day in office, I was interviewed by a reporter about Hurricane Maria, which was a very significant hurricane that affected the island of Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico, there's many, many people from Puerto Rico that live in the city of Lancaster. It's our largest Hispanic community in the city. And we were having this conversation about climate refugees and how we are working to welcome climate refugees. And I started looking around and realizing we didn't have a language access program. We didn't have some of the fundamental tools that we would need to truly be a welcoming city. And so we embarked on a really, I would say, rigorous process. We've now been recertified as a welcoming city. We continue to be part of this cohort of welcoming cities and learning about how do we do this. We have, I'm the second most requested language is Spanish in the city of Lancaster, and the third is Swahili. So that gives you a sense of the diversity of our community and the needs of our community. So that certified welcoming, that designation, if you will, does play a part in what our programming is. So we have to demonstrate that we are connecting with communities from across the globe and even residents that are here. So this is really about everybody. We are a welcoming city for folks coming from the Congo. We're also welcoming for folks that are moving here from Brooklyn, which happens a time or two. And so for us, that designation was super important. And the connection to parks is just, that's a place where communities can gather and where we can gather with them to make connections. So Mayor's Neighborhood Month, which happens every year in May. Every week of the month, we're in a different park in the city. We're gathering neighbors, we're sharing resources, we're having like tons of kids running around and playing. And that's our way of connecting people to parks and also to the city and to one another.
I love this point too, that it's not just about, I mean, we focus so much on the built environment, right? Parks being accessible to so many people and accessible to vulnerable communities, but at the same time, it's about the processes, right? And the outreach and being able to include these communities through everything that government does and that planners do. And I think that's such an important point. You know, equitable development is really about making sure, right, that everyone's needs, especially in underserved communities, are met, especially as cities transform over time. So they're not overlooked or forgotten. And I would love to hear, you know, kind of going back to those park projects you mentioned, you know, when you embark upon a park project like the parklet you mentioned, the park pocket park, how is your city making sure the needs of underserved communities are met when you're kind of going through that process?
So this is hard work, especially hard work when you start it before the pandemic, and then you come back to the neighborhood and start knocking on doors, and the same people don't live there anymore because there's been turnover. And what we found in this particular neighborhood that there's been a lot of issues. And so we have this thing called a block strength indicator, which is an index in which we score neighborhood blocks based on a number of rankings. And we're really looking for where are the places in the city that really need some extra attention. Whether that's from an engagement perspective and like, let's go have a block party here, or wow, nobody wants to come out of their houses because there's a significant safety issue. So let's address that safety issue, or there's lighting issues, or the infrastructure of the neighborhood needs some attention. So whether that's street paving or more trash receptacles or so on. So Beaver Street, the 300 and 400 blocks of Beaver Street are kind of like a little bit of a forgotten neighborhood. They sit right between the Southwest and Southeast neighborhoods, which have strong identities. But this neighborhood is kind of a linear neighborhood between these two blocks, two main corridors in the city. And so we are seeing a lot of issues, a lot of turnover in residency, not very many owner-occupied homes. There had been this plan that to create a community garden, but there was just too much shade in the space, and it had gone through a number of hands. It was owned by this private person, then it was transferred to a nonprofit, and then it finally came to the city. And so we realized that we have to go out and just do a lot of engagement, and that before we could even begin talking about the park, we had to talk about all these other things. We had to talk about the drug house at the end of the street. We had to talk about the fact that there was a lot of speeding in the neighborhood and tons of kids running around. And how do we calm traffic? We had to talk about some of the conditions of the housing and trash and all of that stuff. And in that process, which we have had to do three times because of the pandemic and then just some other turnover that happened in the neighborhood, we've now gotten to a place where there's a plan, and we are out funding with that plan, working with the Trust for Public Land for how to bring that to fruition. And it was super complicated, and it took a lot longer than I had ever thought that it would. And so that's been both frustrating and heartening at the same time. That makes sense.
I'd love to hear, because this isn't a process, this is siloed, right? That the government's not just alone in this process. Obviously, you're talking to the community, you're working with TPL, but just, I'm really interested in just learning about the partners that are involved, like who is involved in this process, you know, when it comes from, you know, when it comes to private developers, maybe housing advocates, I mean, there's so many different voices in the city that kind of contributes to these projects. Who are some of these partners that you've kind of, you know, either touched upon during this process, reached out to, or kind of incorporated?
Well, I think that we all, anybody who works in government knows that we can't do as much as we can't do this work on in isolation or alone, as you're rightly pointing out, John. And wow, it's just a long list of nonprofits. So we've engaged some youth serving organizations in helping to think about what more programming we can do in the neighborhood. We've engaged the police, both in terms of enforcement, but also outreach. We've had some kids that, you know, truancy and some low level things. And so we basically created a plan where they were gonna be working with a couple of officers and going out in the neighborhood and doing some trash cleanups and trying to build and forge relationships in that way. We've also worked with some of our larger, nonprofits around service delivery, because, you know, again, if you're just coming in and talking about a park and not addressing some of the other issues around housing and some of the other social service needs in a community, you're going to kind of miss it, because you're not going to get the level of engagement. And so it's really fun now that when I drive down to Beaver Street or walk down, there's always sort of the mayor of Beaver Street that's on the, you know, around, hanging around sort of that area. And, you know, he tells us what's going on. And then our other partners are engaged in that work. So while we're doing the lifting as it relates to the development of the park and the cleaning of the streets and, you know, a level of engagement, we're also making sure that we're connecting. So it's really become more of a holistic, very block by block focus. Which is the underpinning of the approach, because Lancaster City is small enough that we can actually do stuff like this, and big enough that it can matter, because we've got a lot of blocks, even though we're only 60,000 people.
I'd love to also just hear, because I feel like such a common trend right now is that, you know, parkland doesn't just come from cities, right? It's also private land that can be developed, or private developers that add park space, especially after the pandemic. It's such a huge demand from residents. You know, what's been kind of the role of private development in Lancaster, and also how do you see the private sector being kind of incorporated into this equitable development strategy?
Oh, you know, it's hard in cities to think about adding park space when you're a private developer, given the cost right now of doing any kind of development. And we're seeing a lot of developers either have to ratchet up their projects to get the return on investment, so adding floors and things like that in terms of their development, or reducing the size of the projects. We see developers engaging in a park development in large measure to accomplish the requirements related to stormwater management. And a couple of them have brought forward ideas about creating some small pocket parks. But I have to tell you, and this is a risky thing for a mayor to say, those parks aren't always, they're not driven from an equity lens. They're driven from this is an amenity for the folks that are going to live in what are typically market rate or condoed, not affordable apartments in the city of Lancaster. And so I think that our lens from the city government needs to continue to be on parks serving everyone and making sure parks are a place where everyone is welcome. And the strategies and tactics for how we do that often depend on the park and the neighborhood. And we're not always involved in all of that because there are neighborhood organizations that sort of pick that up and run with it. But I would say that it's really hard right now for private developers to give up land for park. And it was a really big move for us in our comp plan to basically take 50 acres of land and say, we're actually not going to use this for housing. It has been, I think for 50 years, it was contemplated as being a large housing development. But it also is situated on a piece of land that had a quarry. And so just the physical infrastructure that's necessary and the cost that it would take to get water and sewer out there is just so enormous. And I think we just landed in a place with this comp plan that we're going to accept the reality of this land. And we're going to restore it back to its wild, its historic roots as a peninsula that it is a rock, essentially, that we are going to be able to really reforest and have an experience of nature there. And that is led by the city, not a private developer.
I'm glad you mentioned those points. I feel like it's such an important point to make with private development, where you have to kind of align your priorities as a city, because the public sector's priorities are obviously different than the private sector's, and you kind of have to align them to get this kind of perfect result, but it's not always easy. That actually kind of relates to my next question, which was really just what hurdles have you faced in park development and creating these new parks that you've talked about and also maintaining existing ones?
Well, I'm going to talk about maintaining existing parks for a minute because we mayors across America right now are facing homelessness crises, and all of us are dealing with homelessness and housing affordability as just absolutely essential. And the city has been leaning into this using ARPA funds and have made historic investments in affordable housing, which is important and still not enough. And so, this conversation about adding park space in lieu of housing is tough, because we really have to show the economics of why housing in a particular place doesn't make economic sense for the residents of the city long term, and why a park would. And so some of the challenges that we have right now is how people are using parks. And so we have had encampments and folks that have been using parks in ways that have not engendered everyone to feel safe in those parks, especially bringing their kids. And we've heard that loud and clear. We have a very, very young population, and there's a lot of families who are fearful about having their kids just go play in parks. And I hear that repeatedly. And so for us, the security of our parks and their welcoming nature has to be balanced with what are we doing to meet the needs of folks that are in our parks that have other needs that are not going to be served by them sleeping out of doors and not having access to services. And at the same time, recognizing that sometimes the folks aren't ready and they don't want any services. And so those challenges are just constant. And I bet most people on this call can think about a park in their community where they're seeing some of this play out. And it's super hard. We've had people sort of set up not so temporary shelters, and our police social worker has gone down. And, you know, we've had some really impressive responses in helping people get into rehabilitation and diverting them out of criminal justice and, you know, getting them into a bed. But sometimes we don't have bed capacity in our shelters. So that's really a significant challenge for us at the moment. And I don't see it going away. And I think parks are that tension in our neighborhoods between folks that are coming into that neighborhood and sort of claiming a bench or claiming an area of a city, a park that is, it's just going to be hard ongoing. So those are some of the challenges with the existing parks. And I would also just say, like, we're trying to do some renovation at a current park, and we're just running into issues like with this group of kids that are ripping rebar out of new sidewalks and, you know, just like vandalism. And, you know, we spend so much money and time, and how do we want to engage? And what we've opted to do is, yes, there's some enforcement element to this, but we've gone around and knocked on all the neighbors' doors around the park and said, hey, we need your eyes and ears. We need to understand what's happening and who is engaging in this so that we can connect with them and have some face-to-face conversations about what they're doing in the park, how they're destroying the assets of the park. And the neighbors have really leaned into that because it's a shared community space, and that's super important. So I think I only answered one part there, John, about current parks and not so much the challenges about new parks, but I'll pause there.
No, those are all great points. And I think it shows you the kind of, you know, the complicated issues when it comes to the true meanings of equity in a lot of different ways. And I'm glad you mentioned that point, because it's already come up by seeing the Q&A about unhoused folks and the kind of issue that I know cities are facing around the country. It's come up so much. Let's talk a bit about, kind of generally speaking, about making parks more equitable. When you're working on these new parks, like the one on Beaver Street and this 50-acre park, which sounds incredible, you know, how does the city kind of think about making parks more equitable when it comes to access, quality, or programming, right? Like, I think going back to this theme of equity kind of being, you know, really stretching this theme because it covers so many different things. I'd love to hear kind of more specifically about how the city thinks about these issues.
We've really leaned into engagement as like the first step in anything that we're contemplating. And out of the comprehensive plan is how this, how these idea of adding this new 50-acre park came to be, because we had 14,000 different interactions with people, both online, in person, at football games, in our parks, in neighborhood meetings, et cetera, talking to them about what are the strengths of the city and what are some of the things that they would still like to see in the city. And so, leaning into the engagement, and you heard me talk about this related to Beaver Street, literally knocking on doors of the blocks that are around where this pocket park would be, talking to them about what their needs are, thinking about what, before we even involve a landscape architect or whatnot into developing or designing, what are we hearing from the community? And then how does that fit? Does that program fit into the park? So we've had, you know, a lot of people who, you know, want more active parks versus more passive, and sort of how do we balance those needs? What is the need in the community in terms of the age of the kiddos? How do we build a park that can grow over time? Things like that. And so for me, the equitable development part starts absolutely with engagement and really listening to what people are thinking about and what they want in terms of their programming. And then, okay, taking that all in and thinking about some of the limitations that we all have. You know, we don't have unlimited money. We don't have unlimited space. We have to think about stormwater and tree canopy and a whole bunch of other stuff. So how do we get all that together and then take it back out to the community? And that's really important because I've seen the city of Lancaster do parks master planning with literally 30 people. And you just, that's like not going to work because the end result doesn't have the buy-in from the neighborhood around it, and they don't feel compelled in the same way to care for it and look out for it. And you have to have those community connections to support a park's success and to program it long-term.
I wanted to go, I actually was thinking about this question before, and you mentioned Beaver Street and the project there, and I saw a question come up in the Q&A about this. You know, you mentioned how this is an area that you don't have a lot of owned occupancy there, and it sounds like sometimes it could be a bit transient of a neighborhood where there might be, you know, kind of people coming and going, especially with the pandemic. You know, thinking about what this park could potentially do to the neighborhood, obviously this is a big theme, comes up in the parks world a lot about displacement from new green space. Is this something that you think about in terms of anti-displacement priorities, things like that?
Yeah, I mean, the focus on Beaver Street is also buying houses from landlords and doing renovations and then selling them to city residents, even those that live on the block as first-time homeowners. And so there is a very strong anti-gentrification effort that's happening. Our challenge is that real estate prices are just, like, we used to be able to get these houses, hold yourself for this, $50,000 to $70,000. If you can imagine buying a house for that much money, that was something that was like realistic in the city of Lancaster not too long ago. People can remember that. And now these houses are selling for considerably more. And then on top of that, we have a number of partners that we work with through our land bank and redevelopment authority that we're shuttling those homes to them. They're doing renovations. And then those are then being turned around to have more owner occupied. So we're trying to balance the owner occupied with the rental, but also prioritizing that the people who are buying the house are from the neighborhood. And I will also say it's a risk no matter what we do. Whenever we're investing in a neighborhood because we don't have, private property can be sold and we don't necessarily know what's happening. And I would say the flipping of houses in Lancaster is a lot.
Yeah.
A lot.
Yeah, which is an issue we're seeing nationwide, especially as we face this kind of national housing crisis in so many ways. Let's talk about something we haven't mentioned yet, which is the fun word in the parks world, funding. How have you been able to tap into any, you know, just interesting funding sources, thinking kind of creatively about parks projects, especially when they're so closely integrated with, I mean, you've mentioned it a bunch of times already about, you know, with other priorities like affordable housing, climate resilience, you know, what's kind of the thoughts around funding right now?
For every project, there is a really interesting stack of funds that go into a park planning. And some of that comes from we always start with looking at how can we manage more stormwater in our open spaces. So we start with stormwater and what aspects of the park can we fund using our stormwater management program. The state, we have a really great relationship with our Department of Conservation and Natural Resources. That has been a pretty significant and steady stream of support. And I would say they really like Lancaster because we do the kind of planning and programming that they can see has buy-in and support from the neighborhood. And because we're so methodical in working through our parks and our park program, they have confidence in our ability to achieve the objectives that we're setting out to achieve. Private philanthropy comes into play. We are regularly looking for private philanthropy, and this is a conversation that led us to partnering with the Trust for Public Land because we just needed to have access to different kinds of philanthropy. For some of you who may be working in larger metropolitan areas, you may have different kinds of, and more of them, foundations. We only have a handful, and so we really have to think creatively about how we do this. Capital bond funds, of course, cities can bring those dollars to the table. And I think that pretty much covers it. We've the funding part is just never the easy. It's always the hardest, and sometimes it takes the longest to assemble all of the funding that's necessary to get us to the finish line. And that can just be painfully like watching, it's just like watching paint dry because it's, you know, the grant deadlines and the cycles are so long, and, you know, you can have really jazzed up neighborhood that's super excited about the project. And then you're like, and now it's time to apply for all the grants and we'll see you in 18 months or 24 months. And then maybe we can go to construction and, you know, in 30 months, or, you know, it's just such a long time horizon. And I think balancing those kinds of expectations with the reality of the process is really tough, because people get excited about, you know, park improvements. They want to see it happen and they don't want to wait.
Yeah, it's, I'm always so curious about the funding part. It's something I'm looking into right now where I'm based in New York. And I was just speaking with a bunch of other park groups around the country the other day. And it's such a hodgepodge. Like, some get a lot of money from the state where they live. Others tap into federal funding. Some are doing interesting things locally. Some are like really kind of hell bent on the private philanthropy, but it's like such a mix. I feel like there's no kind of silver bullet by any means.
And New York has a really awesome trust, I believe, that helps to fund their parks. And oh, wow, that's a dream. I actually invited them to come to Lancaster for us to learn about how they set that up, to see what it would take. And it's really tough because there's just so many competing priorities.
Yeah. Yeah. And I would say that the kind of code's been cracked for some of the larger, more popular parks, but the small neighborhood parks definitely still, they haven't quite figured out the formula for making sure those parks, which I would say are just as important.
Yeah. I'm also really curious about how communities brand their parks, and how they use that sort of brand to generate additional visibility and support for the parks. And so, yeah. And that's something that maybe someday we'll be able to get to.
Absolutely. I wanted to kind of mention, I see a question in the Q&A about, you know, equity, of course, is about making parks accessible to as many people as possible for, you know, specifically underserved communities. But, you know, you talked a lot about very specific underserved communities in Lancaster. And I just wonder if, you know, other specific policies and program levers that a mayor could use to let's say specifically focus on the Latinx refugee population, you know, to help with park access or things like that, you know, really kind of like honing in on specific community needs and what that looks like.
Yeah. So, you know, it's such an interesting mix because we have a park that is very popular with teams that represent the Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico, and there's a big softball. And so recognizing that component and engaging them in the parks planning, making sure that the fence is exactly where it needs to be for a regulated softball field and all of these things. And then them coming and bringing, making sure that we have facilities because when they come for the day, they bring their families, there's food, they need to have picnic tables and things like that. So that was actually one of the best examples I can think of is like, how do we engage that community that had been using this park historically, where the facilities were, you know, meh at best. And we wanted to upgrade those facilities and engage them in the process of doing that because they use the park and we want them to use the park and continue to use the park for their programming. So that's one example, one way. I would say another one that's coming up very very soon in September is called our Unity Cup. And it's a soccer tournament that the Lancaster Rec Commission is putting together. And so that's going to be utilizing a park space for a series of soccer games and bringing cultures together around a game that is very familiar, whether you're from Syria or the Congo or you're from, you know, Colombia, South America, that is a universal language. And so we try to think about programming our spaces in ways that are connecting dots. And it often comes with events. But through those events, people become familiar with the park and then they may be coming back, they're bringing their kids, things like that. But it's super intentional and it doesn't, if it just organically happens, there's somebody there that is sort of making that happen and it's not local government.
Yeah, absolutely. It makes me think of, there's this park very close to where I live where when they were planning the park, they were doing outreach and they found out that there was quite a big local Ecuadorian population. And actually, this population was complaining that there was nowhere to play their specific kind of volleyball that they play in Ecuador, which is actually much taller nets than usual. So they put these nets in, and I think this park is full from like 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. because it's one of the few places. And it's because they did that outreach and had someone Spanish speaking on staff to find out that this community is here, doesn't feel like they have anywhere to go. So it's a really interesting kind of just like targeting it. But I like that you make that point about there is someone always kind of driving that either from the community or from the government.
Yeah.
Okay. I want to kind of shift in our last kind of 15 minutes that we have. I want to shift over to thinking about you. I think a lot of folks in the audience probably love hearing a mayor that just like gets the parks conversation. It's probably really refreshing for some folks to hear that. You know, as a city leader, you know, what do you think needs to happen for more leaders to see parks as a higher priority on their list?
Oh, you know, it's so personal how to make a connection to an elected official who maybe doesn't see parks as a priority, and how to connect with something that they do see as a priority and parks, and finding that sort of entree point, inviting them to a park, inviting them to participate in something that's happening in a park, and then being very, very intentional again about connecting, like, hey, this is happening here, and this is how this is related to one of your priority areas. Or did you know communities that have really strong parks also have a strong economic, that's a strong economic development driver in the neighborhood that's around them? Things like that, that can help make the connection. But it's just work. And I know nobody wants to hear about more work, but That is a huge part of it. It's also coming to a city and offering to do things to help improve parks, or say, you know, we've been hearing from this neighborhood and you might be too, or having that neighborhood come with you, bring constituents with you to talk about the importance of parks and why they want to see certain investments in their parks and why that matters, I think is another strategy. I'm repeating myself, but it's just such a personal thing, and you have to find that connection. And in bigger cities where it's the mayor isn't quite as accessible as me, you know, you can catch me walking down the street, walking home from work, you know, going to market, whatever. It's different because I can be easily found. And that's not the case. We unfortunately weren't able to be joined by the deputy mayor of Los Angeles, but you know, that's just at a whole other level. I mean, it's the second largest city in the country. It's completely different. And so I think I'm maybe suggesting some things that you may have to start with a person that is not in the mayor's office to start, to just understand, hey, tell me what the mayor's priorities are. How can we get this conversation going, and really enrolling people internally as well as externally.
I know also, you know, one thing that always kind of helps too, and you mentioned this earlier, is making the economic case, right? So with that 50-acre park, when that was thinking of becoming housing, I mean, you had to really make a case that park, it being a park, is also a really great thing for the community. Just, you know, what have you found most compelling when you're kind of pitching that argument and making that case that parks are also economically beneficial for a city? How have you made, you know, what have you found most compelling in that argument when you're making it to different audiences?
Well, I'm going to be making it more strongly in September and October, John. So if there's ideas,
good, you can use this as practice.
Yeah, I'm up for that. So what we did, a lot of cost calculations related to infrastructure, and then we looked at what the property taxes would be, and also the history of the developer that was last working in this project that kind of threw up their hands and said we're not going to be able to proceed, and that happened in 2019. So I have some of their pro forma numbers to show that, yes, they would have to, this is what their tax liability would be. And then this is what their what they would need to be paying in a association fee to maintain all of the stormwater management that would be required, because it's a rock and there's all this water that would be basically running down these pretty steep slopes into the river, and how that's not going to work. And so by having by being able to talk about the pros and the cons of this very intensive built environment and what those ramifications would be from an environmental perspective, as well as the cost. And then on the flip side, being able to talk about how we can think about this space in a completely different way and have this connection to something that is historically significant in our community and wild. Like, we don't have parks like that in our midst. And it would also connect to county parks, which has more of that, but this would be a little bit different. So I'm still working it out, John, is what I would say, my economic argument. I mean, I will say we also bought a piece of property that's alongside of an existing park to expand that park. And in large part, we did that because there's a lot of security issues related to the building and the sight lines that was there. And it's just, you know, it's just a throw up building. It's not anything of historic significance. Once we take that building down, there will be more play space, and the sight lines into the park and the neighborhood will, we just got lots of complaints about some illegal activities that were happening because it was dark. It wasn't maintained well, et cetera. So we bought it, and now we're gonna advance that as part of the expansion of the park. Those kinds of arguments around safety are always easier than around the economic development.
Yeah, perhaps a bit more tangible for folks, or
more appealing to a bit. Right behind that park.
Yeah, absolutely. Before I kind of move into my closing questions, I'd love to ask just how you're measuring success, you know, when you're doing these efforts to improve strategies and programs for more equitable parks. How do you measure success? Are you measuring success? Is it something that you think about?
So I measure success in a few ways. One, we use our block strength indicator, which I mentioned before, and sort of what we're seeing in the neighborhoods related to the needs of that neighborhood for services from the city and beyond. I also rely on our park staff and our police to give me temperature checks about what they're seeing in parks around the neighborhood. So we have certain officers that I know that I see on a regular basis, or I'll just be driving around and I'm just eyes on a park, which is a very informal way, but you do get a little bit of a, You understand what's happening in a park at different times of day. But I would say our block strength indicator is probably our biggest quantitative metric about parks and their impacts in neighborhoods and what's happening. And then, of course, you know, when you're mayor, things rise to the top because you start hearing it from multiple places, and so then you're like, okay, this is a thing, you need to pay attention to whatever this thing is. And so I really try to just have it continue to have an ear on the ground. But yeah, this is a place where related to parks, where it's like the programming is super important and the intentionality there is super important.
But I think that's such a good point that you mentioned, though, about both the quantitative and also qualitative, right? So like, data is great. It will, obviously, it's quantifiable, we can see that, but also hearing that local knowledge, I saw someone put in the chat how important local knowledge is, right? And, you know, hearing people on the ground and hearing from what's going on that might not be seen in the data always as readily, I think is a great point.
There's a woman that lives across the street from one of our parks. She sits on her porch a lot. If you want to know anything about that park, you
just ask her. Every park has that one person.
I mean, she's got like a perfect view of the park.
I love that.
I can sit on a porch all day.
Our kind of audience today, right, who's in the crowd, is other city leaders, city staff, nonprofit partners, all of which, you know, all of whom are working to create, you know, the kind of healthy, thriving city that you're describing. What advice would you give to other city leaders in particular? You know, when you convince folks that parks are part of equity, right, are an equity issue, but also, you know, the role that parks can play in equitably developing a city. What kind of advice would you give?
I would start with, does the city have a plan? When was that plan last updated? What is their plan to plan? I would identify some high need areas in terms of park and park infrastructure. I take a look at the 10-minute walk map and understand where there's green spaces, where there is not. And I think that there's just a lot, that level of organizing with information is really important as a starting place to engage with a city. Parks are considered passive, and you know, by a lot of people, they're there. People can use them, we maintain them, et cetera. And I think there's another way that you can introduce the concept of parks being a lot more active to the goals of an administration, as well as to the community. And so when you have a park that's not activated, it's obvious.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Or no one, you know, maybe the city's coming out to mow it, but it's clear there hasn't been any recent investment. There's no tending to the park. You know, there aren't people that are from the neighborhood that are picking up trash or, you know, just regularly walking their dog through the neighborhood park. And those are the parks that, in my mind, are, you know, that's a place where, like, there's such an opportunity to lean in and just begin talking with neighborhoods. And you don't have to be, obviously, a city government official to have a conversation with the neighborhood about, you know, hey, you know, do you ever go across the street and play in that park? And, oh, no, we're never over there. It's not safe. Well, you know, like, you just listen and they'll tell you.
Yeah. And I think it takes that intentionality, right, to really reach out and be like, why aren't you using the park? And then figuring out that kind of the variety of issues.
And often it's a whole lot of different things. And I think that's the part that's the most challenging. If, you know, working in a nonprofit where you're just focused on this one thing, it's really hard because when you start talking about parks, you're talking about neighborhoods and there's all kinds of these different issues that intersect and can feel overwhelming, which is why I would also say, don't go and do it alone.
Yeah. That's actually a perfect segue to the last question I was going to ask you. You know, especially as someone like you who has a background in advocacy, has a background in nonprofit work, is a resident, right? Walking home from work. How can all these kind of different groups, right? The advocacy community, residents, nonprofits, really build political will? I think it's a question that I saw come up with a lot of people in the chat. You know, how can this community really build a political will and convince their elected officials of the benefits of parks?
Yeah, I think this goes right to grassroots organizing and sort of our strategy of block by block. And you really have to, building political will comes with storytelling and narrative. And how do you have the stories talk about what's happening around the parks and the importance of parks? If you're not talking to the people that are living near them and not using them or using them and seeing, you know, sort of what they see. And so building political will has to have a strong narrative. You have to have like your why. And I think being really clear about that why and that why not coming from, quite honestly, a 501c3, but coming from a neighborhood, might mean a lot more to elected officials. And certainly don't come by yourself.
Yeah, that's well put. And I think it shows that each group has its own kind of intent and purpose there and role that can be played. Well, Mayor, thank you so much. That's where all the questions I had, and especially gleaned from the audience as well. Thank you so much for joining. This has been great. I'm super excited to visit Lancaster. I have a lot of family in Pennsylvania, so I visit quite often. Thanks for taking this time out. It's been great chatting about the work that you're all doing, the amazing work. And I want to thank everyone for joining us all, you know, over 100 people. I'm going to pass it over to Christina to kind of wrap it all up. Thanks.
Great. Thank you so much, John. And thank you again to Mayor Sirachi. I think shortly we will have a slide, but I just want to confirm for folks that this recording, this conversation, and the presentation will be available on our website, and you can find the information here. It'll also be available on Twitter as well if you follow us at 10-Minute Walk, and we'll also include it in this Zoom chat. I also urge you to check out our new Key Park Equity Policies Framework, which is also available on the 10-Minute Walk website. We saw quite a few questions around how to get this work done, how other cities are doing it, how can we replicate? So please do check out this framework if you're curious to learn more. Thank you so much again for joining, and we look forward to seeing you at our next roundtable and webinar.